Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us for our presentation titled Update on Screening for Hepatocellular Carcinoma, HCC. It's my pleasure to introduce you to Dr. Khaldoun, Almhanna, Associate Professor of Medicine, the Warren Alpert Medical School of Brown University, Lifespan Cancer Institute, Gastrointestinal Oncology, Rhode Island Hospital. After earning his medical degree from Damascus University in Damascus, Syria, Dr. Almhanna received his Master in Public Health degree at the Case Western Reserve University in Cleveland, Ohio. His research has involved clinical and translational investigations in gastrointestinal tumors. Currently, he is an associate professor at the Warren Alpert Medical School of Brown University and working at the Lifespan Cancer Institute with several talented oncologists to help strengthen the gastrointestinal research portfolio in the GI oncology department. He has been the lead investigator on several multicentral trials and developed his own investigator-initiated treatment. For a complete biography on our speaker, please visit the tab at the top of your screen. If any questions arise during the presentation, we encourage you to submit them in the Q&A box. Our speaker will address your questions following the presentation. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Khaldoun Almhanna. I will now turn the presentation over to him.
Thank you, Alexis, for the introduction. Hello, everybody, and good morning, good evening, good afternoon, depending on where you are in the world. Today, I'll be presenting an update on screening for hepatocellular carcinoma. For a full disclosure, I am presenting on behalf of Abbott, and the information I'm presenting are based on my interpretation of the evidence and clinical expertise. As you all know, hepatocellular carcinoma is a primary liver malignancy that's typically developed in the setting of chronic liver disease and cirrhosis. Primary liver cancer is common, and it's the fourth leading cause of cancer-related mortality worldwide, with over 780,000 reported deaths back in 2018. The five-year survival is still dismal, and it's only 18%. The diagnosis of HCC can be difficult and often requires the use of one or more imaging modalities, and HCC is frequently diagnosed late in its course because of the absence of symptoms and the reluctance of primary care physicians to provide surveillance for their high-risk population. Ideally, we would like to diagnose tumor when they are less than centimeter in size, so all treatment options can be offered, including surgery, local therapy, as well as transplantation. Although for many patients, the diagnosis of HCC can be made with imaging alone, biopsy may be required in patients who lack a history of cirrhosis or other chronic disease, or for those with suspicious but nonspecific finding on imaging. Hepatocellular carcinoma is known to be different between different geographic locations. Looking at this map, you notice the increased incidence and prevalence in certain areas of the world, including Southwest China and West Africa. In the United States, the incidence is around, or the prevalence is 1.8 to 2.4 per 100,000 population. Looking at the pathology, we have a liver injury from NASH or hepatitis that lead to chronic liver disease, which lead to liver cirrhosis and lead to hepatocellular carcinoma. Looking at this slide, we notice that there are several opportunities of screening, so we can intervene before the patient moves through those three stages. Most commonly, is between liver cirrhosis and hepatocellular carcinoma, and hopefully in the future between chronic liver disease and liver cirrhosis as well. We will talk in more details about surveillance in the next several slides. The goal of surveillance, as I said, is to detect HCC at an early stage when it's less than 2 centimeters in size, which has a favorable effect on outcome. The data, unfortunately, on surveillance and surveillance benefit has been very conflicting. Historically, an old randomized trial for screening for HCC in patients with hepatitis B showed that surveillance for high-risk patients can lead to 37% reduction in mortality in patients with hepatitis B infection. Another subsequent meta-analysis showed similar results where HCC surveillance was associated with significant improvement in early tumor detection, of course leading to receipt of curative therapy and overall survival in patients with cirrhosis. More subsequent and recent analysis failed to show any significant evidence that the effect of HCC screening on mortality in patients with chronic liver, that screening can have a positive effect on HCC mortality in patients with chronic liver disease. So how do we go about surveillance? One of the easiest and simplest and cheapest tests is ultrasound. It is a highly specific test with 90% specificity. However, it has low sensitivity. In a meta-analysis, the sensitivity can be as low as 63% in early stage disease. Ultrasound has a lot of limitation. It is very operator dependent based on the radiologist's experience. Patient dependent, depend on their liver, their body habitus, and obviously it failed to detect infiltrative disease. There is a lot of talk about including CT scan and MRI for screening for HCC. However, that has not been established and it will be very costly. Serum alpha fetoprotein. Another screening tool is serum alpha fetoprotein, which is the most commonly used marker for HCC. Alpha fetoprotein is a glycoprotein, which is normally produced during gestation by fetal liver and the yolk sac. Sensitivity and specificity differ and depends on what cutoff is used and the incidence and prevalence of disease, like every other screening test. Elevated serum alpha-fetoprotein is nonspecific and can be elevated in patients with chronic liver disease with or without HCC, and also could be associated with the presence of fibrosis only. Alpha-fetoprotein can be elevated as well in pregnancy and in other malignancies like testicular cancer and gastric cancer. This is a table showing several studies that look at sensitivity and specificity of alpha-fetoprotein in detecting patients of HCC. Obviously, the difference between this study is the cutoff that has been used because it's between 20 nanogram to 200 nanogram, and of course, a different number of cases. Based on this, we see that the sensitivity is all over the place and it goes from 25 to 65%. The specificity is between 80 to 90%. This is again in cross-sectional studies. If we look at another table where we're looking at alpha-fetoprotein on prospective cohort studies, again, we have the same problem. We have sensitivity that is low, ranging between 39% to 65%, and a specificity between high 70 to 90%. And again, it all depends on the number of patients that have been tested and followed. In general, it is accepted that if alpha-fetoprotein value is more than 400 nanogram per ml in the right setting, meaning in a high-risk patient with liver disease or with cirrhosis, alpha-fetoprotein more than 400 is diagnostic of HCC with a specificity as high as 95%. Unfortunately, fewer than 5th HCC cases are associated with such high level of alpha-fetoprotein. Given the problems that we saw with sensitivity and specificity, alpha-fetoprotein has been removed from certain society guidelines, including Organ Transplantation Network and United Network of Organ Sharing as a diagnostic test for HCC. Now we'll move on to another marker, which the prothrombin induced by vitamin K absence 2, PIVKA. It's also sometimes referred to as protein induced by vitamin K absence 2, PIVKA, or DCP, this gamma carboxyprothrombin. What is PIVKA? Normal hepatocytes usually carboxylate prothrombin precursor before secreting it into the blood, which is usually dependent on vitamin K. In patients with HCC, this does not happen, and PIVCA2, which is the precursor of prothrombin, is being secreted to the circulation in a non-carboxylated form or an immature form, which called PIVCA. PIVCA2 is increased in the serum of HCC patient, and it has been recognized not only as a highly specific marker, but also a predictor of prognosis of HCC. According to more recent systemic reviews, PIVCA2 showed better diagnostic performance than alpha-fetoprotein for the diagnosis of early HCC. Looking at several studies that look, again, we're looking at alpha-fetoprotein at a different cutoff level, different number of patients. We look at alpha-fetoprotein sensitivity is comparing to PIVCA sensitivity. And we see that PIVCA carry a higher specificity and in certain cases a higher sensitivity. But again, these were not compared head to head. Another marker is alpha-fetoprotein L3. Alpha-fetoprotein L3 is a fucosylated isoform alpha-fetoprotein where the sugar chain structure of alpha-fetoprotein obtained from patients with liver cirrhosis and HCC have different affinities to lectins. Alpha-fetoprotein in several series have shown to be elevated in patients with HCC and can be detected early. And the percentage of alpha-fetoprotein L3 is highly specific for HCC. Obviously, none of the markers that were presented is a home run. All of them have problems based on the cutoff and based on the incidence and prevalence of disease, and they have a low sensitivity and specificity. That's why some studies start looking at combining these markers. So in this analysis, we see that alpha-fetoprotein alone using the cutoff of 20 nanogram per ml showed a sensitivity of only 60% and specificity of 71%, with again low positive predictive value and 88% negative predictive value. When we look at alpha-fetoprotein 3% alone, again, have the same problem with low sensitivity, high specificity, and high negative predictive value, but low positive predictive value. And the same applied to DCP or PIVCA. When we start adding and using, combining actually those markers, we see that the sensitivity slightly start improving when we add two markers, alpha-fetoprotein plus alpha-fetoprotein L3, alpha-fetoprotein plus PIVCA. And when we add the three together, the sensitivity improves significantly between 60 to 77%. The specificity actually go lower. However, negative predictive value also go up, but positive predictive value low down. This all trigger possibility of combining these in the models to have a better sensitivity and specificity for a test that can lead to change outcome in patients with HCC. For the next several slides, I'm going to go through the current recommendation depend on your geographic location. So screening of HCC based on the American Association for the Study of Liver Disease, the AASLD, currently they recommend ultrasound with or without alpha-fetoprotein every 6 months. Alpha-fetoprotein alone should not be used for screening unless it is done with ultrasound. And the screening again occur between 4 to 8 months, approximately 6 months, as the median time for HCC lesion to grow is 117 days, ranging from 29 to 398 days. AASLD does not suggest performing surveillance in patients with a very advanced disease where treatment options are limited unless the patient is listed for transplant. For the Asian Pacific Association for the Study of the Liver, they have similar screening guideline. They recommend combination of ultrasound and alpha-fetoprotein measurement every 6 months. They use a very high cutoff of alpha-fetoprotein of 200 nanogram per ml for patients with cirrhosis, and they don't suggest screening again to cirrhotic patients who are not eligible for treatment or not on transplant list. For the Japanese Society of Hepatology, the recommendation for screening are different because beside alpha-fetoprotein and ultrasound, they recommend PIVCA2 and alpha-fetoprotein 3. They divide the patient into two groups, patient with high-risk disease and patient with extremely high-risk disease. For the patient with high-risk disease, they recommend screening with ultrasound along with these three tumor markers every 6 months. For patients with extremely high disease, they provide doing it more often every 3 to 4 months. So that's give you an idea of where we are on the screening for HCC in patients who are at high risk. Unfortunately, the data are all over the place and we have a lot of unmet needs. Number one, the incidence is increasing. Number two, the underlying liver disease leading to HCC have changed. So the landscape of screening should change as well. We used to screen patients with hepatitis B. Now we have to start thinking about patients with hepatitis C and NASH and other type of cirrhosis. We have a problem with a lack of highly sensitive and specific tests. This, based on some of the data on the combination, led to creating models that incorporate biomarkers with other clinical aspects of the disease to help predict incidence or progression of cirrhotic patient to HCC. The first model that I'll talk about is the GALAD model, which stands for, or it incorporates gender, age, and three serological markers, including alpha-fetoprotein L3, alpha-fetoprotein, and DCP or BIVCA2. In biomarker study, GALAD has shown to be promising for predicting HCC at an early stage. It's really a mathematic model that incorporates all these variables, including, as I said, the gender, the age, and the serum markers. In recent study that when combined with ultrasound, it can help provide more accurate information for clinician to treat or do more imaging for patient at an early stage. In March 2020, FDA granted a breakthrough device designation for the GALAD score. When we look at the ROC curve for GALAD in comparison to single tumor marker, including alpha-fetoprotein, alpha-fetoprotein 3, and DCP, we see that the GALAD outperform each individual markers. And those are two series from UK and Japan. In a trial where they look at GALAD following resection, they had 326 patients with HCC undergoing resection. 195 patients recurred while 131 didn't. When after resection, the GALAD score had declined in all patients. However, the decline was most marked in patients that had no recurrence by 3 years, which led to believe that maybe serial measurement of GALAD may permit early detection of recurrence. How this data is going to be used prospectively is yet to be seen. Another model is the MORAL model. The MORAL model is model of recurrence after liver transplant. Currently, liver transplant follow, say, the Milan criteria are used to allocate liver to patient with HCC, and it only depend on the disease, the size of the disease, and the patient characteristics. They don't incorporate tumor biology. And this is what this model is trying to do, is looking at alpha-fetoprotein at PIVCA in this simple calculation to see if that predict the recurrence-free survival and overall survival in patient undergoing transplant. It is simple, it's highly accurate tool for predicting recurrence and risk stratification pre and post-operatively. Again, further studies are needed for this model as well for it to be validated for future use. The next model is the ASAP model, or SAP. ASAP stands for age, sex, alpha-fetoprotein, and PIVCA2. This is another model that includes those four variables. It was tested recently in a multicenter trial for patients with HCC secondary to HBV in Asia. It's an online free use calculator. Based on the most recent study, sensitivity was as high as 76% and specificity was 90% in detecting early stage HCC or detecting HCC. This is how the model looks like. So you are giving point based on sex, age, alpha fetoprotein, and PIVK2. And then you calculate the total total points, and that total point will predict your risk. For example, a patient who is 28-year-old with alpha fetoprotein of 3.1 and PIVK value of 19, his risk is very low at 4.3% or probability of HCC risk. And this number can be used to decide on what type of further workup or how often he needs more imaging or more testing. Obviously, if looking here, when the alpha fetoprotein is higher and the PIVK value is higher, we are at risk of 44%. And in this case, the current risk of developing CC is high, and the patient would require immediate further imaging, including triple phase CT or an MRI or further evaluation. Obviously, if the numbers are much higher, like in this panel, and the estimated risk is, or probability of HCC risk is 84%, this patient need also further imaging and evaluation because he is at a higher risk of already developing HCC. The two, GALAD versus ASAP, in general, the variable overlapped in both. They are using similar or the same variable, other than alpha fetoprotein 3. It was not part of the ASAP model because it wasn't significant in predicting HCC in multivariable model that limited its use in hepatitis B in particular. GALAD has not been yet validated in patients with HPV. There was a retrospective comparison that showed that ASAP normogram be better predictive of HCC. However, everything has limitation. These are all small study. There is a lot of selection bias given the design of the study. Patient with HCC, even with the ASAP, were diagnosed at more advanced stage. Some patients who did not have HCC still had elevated alpha-fetoprotein and PIVK2, leading to a high risk calculation. Longer follow-up and specific study in patients with elevated PIVK3 are still needed. And of course, anything need external validation, especially study that compare that test to the standard of care, which is currently ultrasound and alpha fetoprotein. These study are also needed. Again, the data based on the most current study are based on a single assay, and it was for patients with HBV. So validation in non-HPV patients is still needed. In conclusion, HCC is a common and increasing malignancy. It is rapidly rising cause of liver-related death in the United States and in the world. Screening and surveillance for liver cancer could save life with early detection where patients have several treatment and curative options. Multiple societies still recommend HCC screening in high-risk patients. With all the data I presented, I think it's important to understand the strength, the weakness, and the limitation of the available screening method is important. All these new combination of tests and normogram are showing promising results. However, it needs to be validated more in future prospective studies. And integrating this biomarker in HCC treatment pathway as a surrogate for treatment response or disease recurrence, which is important to us as oncologists or to surgeon, is extremely important. This will end my presentation. Thank you very much, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Almhanna, for that outstanding presentation. We will now move into the live Q&A portion of the presentation. As a reminder, please submit your questions via the Q&A box. Our first question is, do you see these models or markers being incorporated in transplant criteria and organs allocations?
As I said, the current transplant criteria include patients and tumor characteristics. So it's tumor size, patient's characteristic, including alcohol use, compliance, psych issues, and infections. It will be nice to incorporate these criteria, but it needs to be really validated prospectively before it is used as a criteria for transplant or allocation of organs.
Now, are any of these tests currently being evaluated in patients following liver transplant, surgical resection, as a predictive for disease recurrence?
So I mentioned that the GALAD model has been used or looked at as a predictive of recurrence following resection and following transplant. However, really how that affects treatment algorithm or frequency of imaging is yet to be determined, because if we're going to depend only on the numbers, we're going to order more tests to cause more anxiety and unnecessary testing without really changing the outcome. So again, this needs to be validated prospectively before we incorporate it. And of course, it has to, we have to make sure that it will affect the overall outcome and survival.
Now, Dr. Almhanna, with the changes in the landscape of treating metastatic HCC, do you see a role of using these models in treatment selections or monitoring response?
So currently, all the drugs that are approved for HCC don't have any predictive marker for response. Tumor markers, especially if fetoprotein, is used as a surrogate for response to treatment. However, numbers are numbers, and they should really be used as a surrogate, not as only predictive of response. We still are going to depend on scanning and imaging and clinical pictures. However, if we have something that's very sensitive and specific, it will sure be helping guiding following response to treatment, not choosing the treatment.
And it looks like we have time for one more question. Is there any role of incorporating cDNA in any of these models?
So circulating DNA is currently being used or tested in several malignancy. It has gone further in certain malignancy than others. In HCC, it has not been established as a predictive or a prognostic model, and it hasn't been part of the standard of care. Obviously, we would like to have more data and incorporating circulating DNA with these markers to predict response or risk of recurrence. Again, these are all very immature and still early in development.
Thank you again, Dr. Almhanna, and thank you to the audience for your outstanding questions. We hope you found today's presentation to be informative and insightful. This presentation will be available for on-demand viewing. Don't miss out on the other valuable presentations on our agenda. Visit the agenda tab in the auditorium for a full listing. Thank you again for your participation, and until next time, goodbye.